Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Unstoppable, a 90-day plan to biohack your mind and body for success, second edition, by Ben Angel. Narrated by Gary Tiedemann. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and visual materials present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Legal disclaimer. This book and its contents are intended for educational purposes only and should in no way be interpreted as medical or any other advice concerning the use of products or services featured in this book. This book reflects the author's personal experience with the products, services, and methods detailed herein, and does not constitute an endorsement or recommendation by publisher or its representatives of any of those products, services, or methods. In addition, the views, opinions, and advice contained in this book represent the views, opinions, and advice of the author and/or any third parties identified herein, and not of the publisher or its representatives. The author is not a certified or licensed healthcare professional, nor an authorized representative of any of the products, services, or methods mentioned in this book. Because the advice, strategies, and recommendations contained in this book may not be suitable for your particular situation, the author and publisher make no expressed or implied warranties and assume no liability whatsoever in connection therewith, including warranties about the type or extent of any benefits to be gained from attempting a similar regimen. The author and publisher recommend that anyone listening to this book consult with the appropriate licensed professionals and other experts before taking any action in connection with or based on the contents of this book. Introduction. Something was horribly wrong, but for the life of me, I couldn't put my finger on it. I was 34 years old and had just completed my last event on a national speaking tour throughout Australia. The second the audience left the room and the doors shut, I lay flat on the ground in utter exhaustion. I had been losing my train of thought all day, and at one point had even asked the audience what I was talking about in mid-sentence. This wasn't the first time it had happened either. After the successful release of my third book in 2014, Flee 9-to-5, Get 6-to-7 Figures, and Do What You Love, I returned home from a solo trip to the US and Canada and started experiencing severe depression, exhaustion, and anxiety. Depression, an old arch nemesis of mine, used to be manageable. This time, however, it didn't matter how much personal development work, meditation, supplementation, exercise, or healthy eating I did, or how much willpower I used. It clung to me like a bad smell. There was no amount of positive thinking that was going to get me out of this downward spiral. Everything had become overwhelming. Even music, which I used to love to listen to while working, became an irritant. Suddenly, light, noise, and social interactions were too much for my brain to process. I couldn't manage social situations anymore and moved across Australia to cut off ties with friends. I barely had enough energy to stay awake, let alone hold a conversation or speak on stage. Reading and writing, my passions, became too exhausting for me to contemplate. My short-term and long-term memory were both failing, and my speech was slurred. Everyone was beginning to notice, no matter how hard I tried to hide it. I became plagued with self-doubt and fear that made every waking moment painful. Worse yet, I began having suicidal thoughts. I beat myself up because the soundtrack in my head was stuck on repeat. It kept saying, "I should know better. I should know how to fix this. Why can't I stay focused? Why can't I think my way out of this one? Why aren't I motivated and driven like I used to be? Where did my confidence and energy go? Why do I feel like I'm not good enough anymore? And what the fuck is wrong with me? I know I'm capable of more." I felt like I was falling out of an airplane without a parachute. I was just waiting to hit the ground, desperately hoping someone would catch me before I came crashing down. Like many of you, I mistakenly thought I could self-medicate with self-help. For years, it had worked. This time, nothing worked, and I wanted to know why. I shared my symptoms with doctors from Adelaide to Melbourne to Dubbo and was confronted with patronizing remarks like, "Most people never work out while they're fatigued. You look fit and healthy. You should be fine." And, "Are you depressed?" I was, but not for the reasons they believed. I walked out of the last office in tears, having been told I needed to accept these symptoms as my fate. This was my first revelation that the medical field had been failing me for more than 20 years. Doctors are trained to diagnose the symptoms, not the underlying cause. I needed to seek out doctors who didn't follow this traditional approach and were willing to investigate deeper with the newest medical advances and scientific research. I needed to find visionary doctors who realized that the traditional model was doing more harm than good. I wanted to dig out the underlying causes from the roots, not cover them up as the doctors would have me do. None of them had any answers. I felt more and more defeated daily, on the verge of a complete mental breakdown. Have you ever had a goal you wanted to achieve, but it always slipped through your fingertips? Have you ever doubted yourself and your ability to the point where you gave up before you broke through? Have you ever given up on yourself, your dream, and your purpose because you felt you had nothing left to give? Have you known you were capable of more, but you didn't know how to unlock that capacity? Have you read countless personal development books, listened to podcasts, or participated in coaching or therapy just to end up right back where you started? No amount of willpower can unlock this dilemma for you. Our hustle until you die culture that applauds those who work themselves into an early grave would peg you as weak-minded. They would say, "You're just making excuses. You're being lazy and failing because you're not working hard enough." Worse yet, they would tell you, "It's all in your head. You just need to push through." But what if it wasn't just all in your head? What if your excuses were a symptom of a deeper problem, not a poor attitude? And what if there were countless scientific links between food, mood, nutritional deficiencies, gut health, inflammation, energy, medication, and psychology being ignored and leading to dangerous consequences? What if the hustle now culture, personal development, and therapeutic and medical models were too simplistic in isolation? These models for success fail to take in the bigger picture of what influences human emotion, behavior, and performance. And worst yet, what if people ended up believing they were worthless as a result of this culture? Every time we log on to social media, we're overwhelmed with articles on the best time to wake up, blog posts on the productivity habits of the super wealthy, and images of people living their best lives, hashtag I woke up like this, all designed to help us become smarter, faster, healthier, more productive, and more empowered. But what if we've had it backward all this time? What if there's more to success than simply hustling for our goals, waking up early, working late nights, and pushing ourselves beyond the breaking point? 4 years ago, I was at my peak physically, mentally, and in business professionally. I was delivering online marketing courses to thousands of entrepreneurs internationally and speaking at business and personal development events in front of thousands of people across Australia. My audiences included local and state governments, universities, and companies like Toyota on the topics of business, marketing, sales, personal development, and personal branding. I was consulting with one-on-one business clients and helping them grow their businesses nationally. And I was traveling between New Zealand and Australia to work with high-profile clients. A regular in the Australian business media, I wrote articles and conducted interviews on a monthly basis, and I loved it. I was interviewed as one of Australia's leading personal branding and marketing experts for magazines including the Australian versions of GQ and Marie Claire, among countless others. Every time I stepped on stage to present, I came alive. I used this energy to write my first three books, two of which became bestsellers, and all three of which I wrote in 30 to 40 days each. My brain was firing on all cylinders, and I had focus like you wouldn't believe. Nothing was too hard, and no problem was too big to solve. I used this energy and focus to build an online education business that boasted more than $1 million in sales with two part-time team members and required only 4 to 5 hours of my time per day. Then, everything changed. I wanted to give it all up, and I couldn't work out why. I was trapped. I couldn't escape, and I certainly couldn't take on a full-time job as I was barely getting through the day. My resume would have read, "Proactive worker who naps a lot." In 2017, I packed my bags and flew to America. You see, I knew I had the capacity in me for more, but for some reason, someone had changed the lock on the door and I couldn't open it. My soul was willing, but my body was weak. Fearful of where my uncontrolled emotions would take me next, I drank several cups of green tea one hot summer's day and pushed myself to come up with a solution. I wasn't willing to give up on 10 years of hard work, but I knew I wouldn't find the answers in a self-help book or at the doctor's office. I had tried and failed miserably. I wanted to know why. In my exhausted state, I came across New York Times bestselling author Dave Asprey's audiobook, Headstrong, the bulletproof plan to activate untapped brain energy to work smarter and think faster in just 2 weeks, in which he shares his journey of coming back from debilitating fatigue by biohacking his body and brain back to health. He gave me hope. Biohacking is the practice of changing the environment inside and outside you so that you gain full control of your biology to enhance your body, mind, and life. It has grown in popularity in recent years as individuals are discovering the numerous benefits of taking control of their health and leaving nothing to chance. So, I did the most illogical thing of all in my state of desperation to feel better. I pitched a book idea to Entrepreneur magazine in which I would go on a 90-day mission to biohack my mind and body and develop a plan anyone could use based on what I discovered from biohackers, neuroscientists, doctors, psychologists, and more. This didn't just mean getting better, it meant continuing to optimize and upgrade my performance. I would isolate my experiments as much as humanly possible and in quick succession, with the goal of uncovering the root cause of my depression sooner. By no means were my experiments scientific, but if I had spaced them farther apart, as I had originally attempted, I wouldn't have put the final pieces of the puzzle together, and my suffering would have been prolonged even further. To begin, I had to ask the same questions we have asked repeatedly for years, but look at them from completely different perspectives to come up with new answers we have never been able to arrive at before. I wanted complete and conclusive answers to questions for which I had received overly simplistic answers. Questions such as, why don't people really change? How can I improve my memory and my confidence? What really holds people back from becoming successful? What is the root cause of procrastination? Is it psychology, biochemistry, or a mix of both? Why do we get stressed? And what are the quickest ways to obliterate it? Why do we make excuses? Are we just lazy? Or is there an underlying cause all the self-help gurus have overlooked? How can I upgrade my focus and increase my levels of motivation? How can I unleash my purpose and live a meaningful life? What is the best way to hack my own body for endless amounts of energy, clarity, and focus? How can I reboot my brain, reimagine my life, and reawaken my soul to become unstoppable so that no goal or dream feels out of reach. In hindsight, that 90-day goal looks insane, especially considering I could barely string a sentence together at the time I pitched the book. All of a sudden, I was going to not only attempt to solve a problem even the doctors couldn't, but also write a book on the new science of success using neuroscience, biohacking, technology, and psychology. But what did I have to lose? I thought I was at the end of my writing career because my cognitive abilities and motivation were no longer accessible. Thankfully, the magazine and its publishing division jumped at the idea. To be honest, I didn't know how this journey was going to unfold. But because my options were fast becoming limited, I threw every last ounce of my willpower and energy, including traveling from Australia to Canada and the United States, into seeking answers. If willpower is the fuel in your reserve tank, mine had one drop remaining. I was going to use it as wisely as possible to completely refuel and reboot my body, brain, and soul. The only way I could achieve this mission would be to close my identity gap. The identity gap is the distance between who you are and who you need to become to reach your goals. Our identity dictates our thoughts, behaviors, and actions, and either sets us up for success or primes us for failure at both a conscious and subconscious level. It limits or expands our thinking and our ability to succeed, depending on which identity we hold at any given time. You can't be a good accountant if you're a painter at heart. Our capacity for success is limited by who we believe ourselves to be, to the degree our biochemistry allows us to be it. We hold various identities throughout our lives: mother, father, brother, sister, entrepreneur, employee. But what about an identity that allows us to unlock our potential and live a life unleashed? We need to evolve into a person who can be more, do more, and have more. Someone who can become a catalyst for change and never-ending improvement. This is the beautiful self-evolution of who you are becoming in the pursuit of your goals, an evolution that stretches us and encourages us to grow. When we fail, it is because we have failed to evolve into the person we need to be to solve the necessary problems to break through. To find new answers, with a tremendous amount of love, support, and fatigue, I traveled the world and met with the top biohackers, neuroscientists, doctors, and microbiome experts. I tried out the latest wearable technology designed to unlock human potential. Many of these devices, funded by the Pentagon and the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, are being used by the military and Olympic athletes. I tested the latest smart drugs to boost my focus, mood, and cognition, and met with the best of the best working in revolutionary medicine, who performed comprehensive lab tests to uncover any physiological problems affecting my mood and motivation. You'll discover how my medications, nutritional deficiencies, and foods influenced my behavior, what changes I embraced to correct that behavior, and how these factors could be impacting your life. You'll also discover how using the latest neurotechnology devices trained my brain to focus, and how I tested my body with a 4-week CrossFit challenge. You'll hear about the changes I went through when I experienced intermittent fasting, experimented with various dietary protocols, tracked my sleep, took countless supplements, and tested technology that reduced my stress in less than 30 seconds. I even walked across hot coals to find some answers, literally, not metaphorically. Although that might not have been as nerve-wracking as the colonic irrigation I had. What I found was truly jaw-dropping. By using the real science of success, I was able to bring myself back to full health and help others in the process. In the following chapters, I dive into the real science of success, not just the simplistic version we have subscribed to that is far too limiting. Along this journey, You will also meet others who, through persistence, have overcome serious challenges to become unstoppable in their fields by biohacking their way to the top. I welcome you now to join me on what ended up being an incredible journey. Buckle up, you're in for a ride like no other, one that will result in an incredible paradigm shift into the science of success you never saw coming. Upgraded and expanded. In 2020, the world received a wake-up call that shook us to our core. We saw huge economic losses, millions of people out of work, and a bigger public health crisis than some of us have ever experienced in our lifetimes. Even the most steadfast individuals were left in shock, wondering what their next move should be. We saw panic and fear spread like wildfire, and collective stress permeate everyday life. Many people were paralyzed by that fear, while others jumped into action to stem the losses and keep their families and friends safe. These events called on us to become unstoppable and practice a level of emotional control that even the most seasoned meditator would have trouble with. They shone a light on our physiological and psychological health in a way that had many of us asking, "Do I have the emotional resilience and energy to overcome this?" Although I didn't realize it at the time, Unstoppable was made for a time like this because it looked at new and proven ways to build the courage and strength to keep going when all many wanted to do was give up. A lot has happened since I wrote Unstoppable in 2018, and not just world-altering events. With the groundswell Unstoppable created, we launched an online course titled The 13-Week Mission to Becoming Unstoppable that has seen more than 15,000 people join. We released the Unstoppable Journal, a daily planner, a first of its kind with a complimentary mobile app. And we surveyed more than 50,000 people to uncover what was holding them back, both psychologically and physically. Unstoppable also won Best Motivational Self-Help Book in the 2020 International Book Awards and was a finalist for Best Psychology Book of 2020. Better yet, we've helped prevent suicides and helped people reclaim their bodies, brains, and lives after battles with crippling depression, exhaustion, and anxiety. It wasn't easy. A month after the first edition was published, my bank account was $3,000 in the red. I had put everything I had, financially and emotionally, into this project in the hope that it would change lives. It was a huge risk, but I'm glad I took that leap. I also put my work under a tremendous amount of scrutiny to get it right. We had 3 scientific, medical, and independent fact-checkers and editors critique it, and then we sent it to doctors, psychologists, clinical social workers, athletes, and nutritionists for review, all of whom praised this revolutionary new approach. Now, with an abundance of additional data, countless testimonials, tens of thousands of readers, and brand new advances in the health and wellness space in hand, we felt it was time to upgrade Unstoppable. But that's not because our original strategies didn't work. In fact, they worked so well, we have doctors, psychologists, cognitive behavioral therapists, and nutritionists recommending the online course and book to their patients. We decided to upgrade it because what's happening in the world requires us to be the best we can be, strong, resilient, and compassionate individuals who have what it takes to make it through any challenge life throws at us. For that, we needed to go even further down the rabbit hole into neuroscience, technology, psychology, and biohacking to ensure no stone is left unturned and no person is left behind. For readers of the original edition, you're going to love being introduced to brand new insights into peak performance and mental health that you've yet to explore. I'm humbled you've decided to take the next critical steps with me on this new mission to become unstoppable. But before you dive in, remember, I hear you, I see you, and I get you, because I was you at the height of your struggle. But most important, I am here for you whenever you encounter a challenge or want to optimize yourself for the road ahead. Ben Angel. Part 1. Deciphering Your Identity Gap. Chapter 1. A Paradigm Shift, Decades in the Making. Closing Your Identity Gap. I was on the verge of a breakdown and beginning to have suicidal thoughts, and I didn't know where to turn. My life at this point was an absolute lie. I was touted as the agent of influence to hundreds of thousands of devoted entrepreneurs and companies, yet I couldn't even motivate myself to look at my next goal, and I was angry about it. It was my dream to move to New York and continue my career as an author. I had visualized this goal countless times. I could see myself walking the busy city streets, going to cafes and restaurants, and yes, even having my own Carrie Bradshaw moment writing in the window of a classic New York City townhouse. Don't judge me. However, for reasons that eluded me, I couldn't even bring myself to look at my to-do list. It was too overwhelming. I was fast becoming what my industry sees as a has-been. My dream was getting further and further out of reach, and it didn't matter how I tried to convince myself that I was okay. The truth was, I wasn't all right, and nobody had any answers as to why. You may be able to relate. You know you're capable of more, but for some reason, you can't unlock the capacity to thoroughly express it through your purpose, your vision, and your goals. Your dreams always feel just out of reach, and no matter how hard you try to stretch yourself to grasp it, you always fall short. You try to convince yourself that you'll get up earlier, work harder, and do whatever it takes to achieve your goals, but time after time, you miss. Is it us? Do we just have a poor attitude? Do we just need to toughen up? What are the super successful people doing that we're not? I followed their strategies, but I didn't get their outcomes. Why? We're taught that if you're sad, you need to be more positive. If you're angry, you need to find peace. If you're procrastinating, you're lazy. If you're making excuses, you're weak. It's all in your head. Pick up a self-help book and get over it. And yet, if you go to a doctor complaining of these same symptoms, you'll get a medical diagnosis of depression and be put on antidepressants to fix a chemical imbalance in your brain. Even then, the doctor can't take the time to find out the cause of your decline, thanks to training, attitudes, and time constraints. What's worse is that the self-help industry looks at these same symptoms and believes an injection of motivation and an inspirational story is the answer. It's not interested in finding out the underlying cause either. This realization led me to ask, if these are my symptoms, what is the cause? We all experience setbacks to varying degrees throughout our lifetimes, some more severe than others. Since 2018, we have surveyed more than 50,000 people internationally, asking each one 30 questions related to their psychological and physiological well-being. As a result, we have collected a staggering 1.5 million pieces of data, revealing compelling patterns that we'll investigate. We discovered the following revelations. 75% experienced brain fog. 82% experienced procrastination. 82% were easily distracted. 65% were easily overwhelmed. 71% experienced high levels of stress. 58% did not wake up feeling refreshed. 47% experienced sadness. 62% had inconsistent energy throughout the day. 65% got caught in a negative mental feedback loop. Furthermore, our survey indicated that 54% of them were experiencing depression to varying degrees. These numbers are astonishing in that they demonstrate an overwhelming percentage of the population are struggling to get through the day, minute by minute, hour by hour. In this specific demographic, we have highly motivated people who are passionate about their goals and embedded in a workforce that is usually made up of the movers and shakers of the business world. Yet, an overwhelming number of them are not enjoying complete wellness when it comes to their mental health. How many of them will burn out before they can achieve their dreams due to biological factors and past unhealed traumas? By looking more carefully, we can see that there are underlying causes triggering these symptoms. I firmly believe we can cure ourselves of this disease of elusive well-being. Especially in the United States, we are seeing an epidemic of prescription drugs as the answer to these symptoms, and the medical industry is not yet willing to trade in their prescription pads for questionnaires to discover the root causes of our decline. Closing the gap to who you are supposed to be. My story is not the exception to the rule. It is the rule. These are all symptoms of an underlying issue completely ignored by the personal development industry and the medical profession. Like a frog, which will slowly die when put into tepid water that's then brought to a gradual boil, we too will adapt to our suffering without conscious awareness until severe symptoms appear and medical intervention is required. At that point, a scorched earth approach is taken instead of a preventative one. All these symptoms decrease our mental ability to process new information, with hazardous implications when it comes to closing the identity gap from our current self to who we need to become to reach our goals. In particular, it limits who we believe ourselves to be and our perceived ability to bring our visions to life. Even if mild, it snaps us back into who we are at our worst. It wasn't until after visiting a doctor in the rural city of Dubbo in New South Wales, Australia, that I had my first major realization after what ended up being another patronizing interaction that left me wondering if I would ever feel better again. Looking at the conundrum. I wasn't tired because I was depressed. I was depressed because I was tired. I want to know why I'm tired. Being depressed as a result of fatigue was the first of many discoveries that helped me uncover the solution, not just to my symptoms, but to reaching my goals and rewriting my model for success from the ground up. If I could discover why I was tired, making excuses, and procrastinating, everything else would fall into place. I would finally get my motivation and drive back, quit making excuses, and reignite my energy and passion for the projects I used to love. Like millions of other people, I had started off with mild symptoms that I quickly dismissed as the result of overworking, a weak mental attitude, or late nights and tight deadlines. I had subscribed to the philosophy of just do it without being fully aware of the consequences. When the soul is willing, but the body is weak, the body can't fulfill the mission the soul is on. My soul was more than ready, willing, and able. Despite reading countless self-help books, attending seminars, and drowning myself in motivational strategies for 15 years, I realized that the information I had was sorely incomplete because it only ever resulted in a quick burst of motivation before quickly running dry again. We've been taught that our psychology is the number one key to success. Our biochemistry doesn't get a mention unless you're an elite athlete or experiencing severe physical symptoms that are obvious to others. But even mild biochemical problems can prevent you from reaching your goals. Strategic planning, mindset, and willpower are essential for one's ability to think and compete on the job and in life. These factors can make one a legitimate competitor. However, biochemistry, which fuels one's endurance and tenacity, provides the speed to succeed. We tend to automatically assume that we're all biochemically on par with the likes of Tony Robbins, Richard Branson, the Dalai Lama, and other peak performers. But some of them actively work to hack their biochemistry. Others, through a combination of factors we'll be talking about in this book, got lucky. Their biochemistry naturally makes them less susceptible to stress, brain fog, and sadness, helping clear the path for their success. That's not to say they don't experience these ailments. They do, but to manageable degrees. Nor is it to say they don't work hard. It just doesn't seem as hard because they are biochemically sound, establishing a firm foundation on which everything else, especially emotional resilience, can flourish. We imitate their strategies. We want to know what time they get up, what they eat, how they think, what their core beliefs and reading habits are. But not for one second do we consider that each of us is biochemically unique. We each process our food, thoughts, and emotions very differently due to numerous factors, factors we ignore in the quest for personal success, unless one of our goals is to lose weight. Anyone can apply the same psychological principles as the ultra-successful, but if you're severely depleted on things like vitamin D, omega-3s, vitamin C, vitamin B12, dopamine, serotonin, or even testosterone, both women and men, you could experience mild to severe brain fog, fatigue, lethargy, anxiety, stress, and depression, all of which will severely impede your ability to remain focused and reach your goals. It's like putting a plant in toxic soil and willing it to grow. It doesn't matter how much you tell it anything is possible, that fucker is going to die. Ignorance of biochemistry undermines the psychological principles we're taught to apply. It's the invisible factor that derails us, an unseen hand that holds you back from crossing the finish line. Without this information, any strategies for productivity and peak performance are incomplete and ineffective. Instead of realizing our biochemistry is out of alignment, we attach a negative emotional mental state to our goals and decide the goal itself is too hard or too lofty. We end up with self-defeating thoughts, such as, I'm too tired. I haven't got time for this. What's the point? I feel too overwhelmed. Or, I'm so stressed. To avoid that scenario, perhaps we should ask ourselves a few questions. What if instead of just studying the habits of highly successful people, our best creative minds, and multimillionaire game changers, we compiled a database of their medical data that examines their serotonin and dopamine levels and microbiome makeup, and compares it to those who routinely quit, make excuses, or experience more intense negative emotions? Would poor biochemical results impact their ability to cross the finish line? Do these biochemical levels impact the abilities of the highly successful to overcome setbacks and cross the finish line? Would these biological processes provide a real and complete understanding as to why successful people behave a specific way, not based on their mental attitude and upbringing alone? If a person were able to deplete their dopamine and serotonin levels, how would their behavior change? Could a successful, confident person be incapacitated physically and mentally as a result of nutritional deficiencies? If we were to look at their biochemical levels when they encountered a major setback, what would we discover? Upon examining other aspects of a person's life during a major physical and emotional setback, what would we find? What were they eating at the time? How did their behavior change? What occurred in the body, not just in their attitude? We are, of course, setting aside the ethical dilemma of compiling such a database. These questions are purely hypothetical. The only time we consider biochemistry is when we're in decline or attempting to lose weight, not when we're trying to become a better version of ourselves. When we fail to reach our goals, it's implied we have a weak mental attitude, not a biochemical weakness that can be rapidly rectified with the right help. true personal transformation requires both biochemistry and psychology for lasting change. Otherwise, we'll default back to what's easy. When the brain is weak, the output will be meek. One finding in our survey of 50,000 was unexpected, but is blindingly obvious in hindsight. 57 to 65% of those experiencing brain fog were easily distracted, often procrastinated, lost their train of thought, and felt overwhelmed and sad, and were also experiencing food cravings. This was a major contributing biochemical factor as to why their day was being derailed and why they tended to give up. This discovery further led me to believe that success isn't only in the mind or body, it's in both. To be truly successful means not only hacking our minds, but hacking our chemistry as well. Looking at this conundrum from a new perspective challenged everything I believed about self-help. I, like others, had been led to believe that you can will your way out of your excuses, procrastination, brain fog, negative thoughts, and sadness, but if you're depressed, you need a drug. But what if that's not true? How much does psychology play a part in your success, and how much does biochemistry play a part? The reality is that you cannot use mental ability to compensate for inadequate biochemistry. It can help, but unless you address and understand the underlying issues, avoidance and procrastination will continue. Your personal development practices will only be effective when your biochemistry is working at peak efficiency and supporting your body to its fullest. New approach to old problems. What do you tackle first? Your mindset or your biology? In the past, we'd pick up a self-help book or seek out a therapist who might or might not address our nutritional deficiencies. These approaches might have been fine a decade ago, before the major changes to our environment and food supply, light pollution, and the psychological impact of social media began affecting our daily behavior. However, our prehistoric brain hasn't caught up with today's technological advances. Our biochemistry is stuck in our evolutionary past. As a result, we're glued to our computer, phone, and notebook screens 24/7, and this addiction to technology is having a profound impact on how we behave. Studies show that social media and app companies are using their technology to create addictive platforms, for which we unknowingly pay the price. They are using cute emojis and keeping track of how many times we use their app, thus creating an addictive social media habit. These habits become pleasing to the user, embedding the need to do it again for that brief hit of pleasure. Facebook has admittedly hijacked one of our neurotransmitters, dopamine, for financial gain. Dopamine, otherwise known as the reward chemical, due to it being in charge of our brain's pleasure reward system, can give us the drive and focus we need to be productive. Unfortunately, we aren't always aware that this is happening until we feel it impacting other areas of our life. Dopamine is a key component in various brain functions involving sleep, learning, motor control, working memory, and our ability to focus and concentrate. Parkinson's, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, and other conditions are at the extreme spectrum end of abnormally low dopamine levels. In other words, is social media addiction a result of lower dopamine levels due to stress and the modern world we now live in? Excuses, procrastination, and brain fog are possible symptoms of deficient levels of dopamine, not the causes. That's when I was hit with a blinding flash of the obvious. My excuses, negative thought patterns, and lack of drive and motivation weren't simply the result of a weak mental attitude. The problem was far more complex and multifaceted than even my doctors had realized, but each of them only focused on one aspect based on the model of treatment they practice. No one is inherently unworthy, useless, or weak. We all fluctuate throughout our lifetimes. Life, as you'll find out through the course of this book, is not a controlled experiment. Positive thinking isn't a substitute for a nutritional deficiency. Unfortunately, we don't associate vague symptoms such as low self-esteem, anger, carbohydrate cravings, digestive complaints, feeling overwhelmed, insomnia, joylessness, brain fog, and poor cognitive function with low serotonin levels. Instead, we beat ourselves up for not being as good as everyone else. With that in mind, could my internal chemistry be triggering my procrastination, fear, anxiety, and greater willingness to quit? I had only ever experienced these fleetingly in the past, and they always subsided. This time, they had laid roots I had to dig up. The short answer is a resounding yes. You are not your excuses. Your excuses are your biochemistry. Diagnosing failure. The greatest problem with our old approach to success is that it fails to bridge the gap between biochemistry and psychology. The two are so intertwined they cannot be separated, and yet our medical system, the personal development industry, psychologists, naturopaths, nutritionists, and therapists have drawn lines between their methodologies for decades that have led to emphasizing psychology over biochemistry, or vice versa, but not a combination of both. This old approach also creates a stigma for how people are meant to experience depression. It is expected that if you are depressed, you will want to self-isolate. But there's another side, one that I know all too well. Putting on a strong public front that everything is fine and you're doing well. Either way, people suffering with depression don't get the help they need. The problem with this framework is that it often results in people taking their lives and their loved ones being at a loss as to what was wrong and missing out on a chance to help them. We've heard many tragic stories from members of our online program who have had family or friends take their own lives. It is my hope that by sharing my own story and my very clumsy and originally unscientific attempt to get better, that I can start to reframe our perception of depression and eliminate the stigma that prevents people from asking for help so their friends and families get that chance to be there for them. The true evolution in treatment will occur when all practices of medicine begin to converge and develop a deeper understanding for what people with depression go through. This is beginning to occur in the field of functional medicine, and it will revolutionize healthcare and the way we think about ourselves and the science of success. But before we address success, let's talk about failure. Why we really fail. Failure isn't just due to low dopamine levels. It's also a question of managing our fight-or-flight response. When we're stressed, the body's sympathetic nervous system triggers this response. The body kicks into high gear and shifts its energy resources toward fighting off a threat or fleeing from an enemy. A long-held belief has been that adrenaline drives the fight-or-flight response, which sets off a cascade of internal processes, including the release of cortisol, increased respiration, fast heartbeat, and blood vessel dilation in the arms and legs. This, in turn, triggers our digestive system to increase our bloodstream glucose levels to deal with the emergency. Once the threat is over, everything returns to normal. But a 2019 study from Columbia University researchers suggests that a hormone found in bones, not adrenaline, triggers the fight-or-flight response. They uncovered that in humans and mice, after the brain detects danger, it almost instantaneously floods the bloodstream with osteocalcin, a bone-derived hormone that helps your cells process glucose. The researchers say this may explain why adrenaline-deficient individuals can still experience a physical fight-or-flight response to threats. They also discovered that osteocalcin surges in people undergoing the stress of speaking in public. What does this mean for future treatments of chronic stress, in which individuals are constantly stuck in a low-grade fight-or-flight mode? That remains unclear, but we may be on the verge of medical breakthroughs that will help us solve a problem we all experience. If chronic stress continues over an extended period, it can cause problems ranging from cognitive impairment and emotional instability to physical illness. Emotional symptoms include agitation, moodiness, feeling overwhelmed, an inability to relax, low self-esteem, worthlessness, depression, and isolation. Physical symptoms could include headaches, low energy, upset stomach, muscle tension, chest pain, insomnia, colds and infections, loss of desire, nervousness, shaking, or difficulty swallowing. Stress can also lead to cognitive symptoms, racing thoughts, forgetfulness, disorganization, inability to focus, brain fog, poor judgment, pessimism, and constant worrying. Stress, food cravings, and an inability to focus on what matters. Stress also plays a role. A staggering 71% of our 50,000 respondents said yes to experiencing high levels of stress. And here's where it gets fascinating. Stress causes food cravings, specifically for sugar and highly processed food. The digestion of this food releases the neurotransmitter serotonin, which brings us waves of calm and relaxation, allowing us to regain our focus temporarily until the serotonin levels taper off. Between 57 and 65% of our respondents who reported being plagued with brain fog, feeling overwhelmed, worrying, and sadness also experienced food cravings. Carbohydrate cravings can be spurred on by low serotonin levels, as this feel-good chemical is released during the consumption of food. This results in a negative feedback loop, driving people to consume excessive amounts of carbs to alter how they feel for the better. These cravings are often seen in individuals who are exposed to high levels of stress. The connection to our inability to succeed lies in two factors that are at play on a day-to-day basis. When we experience food cravings or stress, our fight-or-flight response is triggered. This takes blood away from our prefrontal cortex, which controls a myriad of executive functions, including complex behaviors like coordination, impulse control, emotional reactions, personality, focusing, organizing, complex planning, and prioritizing simultaneous information. This sets up a nasty cycle. Our blood sugar drops, our cravings increase, and our cortisol spikes, limiting our ability to control our impulses, attention, and emotional reactions. We reach for sweet or highly refined carbohydrates, and our blood sugar increases, followed later by a sudden drop, which results in brain fog, inability to focus, loss of motivation, and the inability to reach our goals. We attempt to address this cycle in our children by limiting their sugar intake, and yet, we dismiss it when it comes to our own psychological well-being. We've also been duped by companies that are putting a healthy spin on their products, even though many of them are high in sugars, sucralose, refined carbohydrates, caffeine, and preservatives, all of which impact our ability to think clearly. When your blood sugar drops or you experience high levels of stress, your brain switches into survival mode, driving you to take more risks and putting your primal brain into high gear. This shift causes your personality, mood, and identity to fluctuate throughout the day. Your motivation may be high in the morning, but by the afternoon, you'd rather sit on the couch and watch TV because you've used up all your mental capacity for the day. In this primal state, the brain's key purpose is to sustain life, not keep you focused on achieving your goals. That doesn't even get a rating on the scale of critical functions necessary for your life to continue. In this state, otherwise known as self-preservation mode, you default to maintaining the status quo and nothing more. The problem is that most of us can't switch it off, or if we do, it quickly comes back on again later, creating a roller coaster ride of emotions and an inability to complete projects on time. How easily it comes on is directly linked to how we've learned to process possible threats. This is based on numerous factors, including our upbringing, genetics, and hormone levels like serotonin and dopamine, just to name a few. If your serotonin or dopamine levels are low, you're more susceptible to dealing with setbacks poorly and more likely to have a reactive instead of responsive internal environment. Our current lifestyles bombard us with stress factors daily once the pebble starts rolling downhill from something that seems inconsequential at the time. Examples of these stress factors could be a reaction to unhealthy foods, allergies, bad news, insomnia, pollution, hostile coworkers, financial stress, too much caffeine, relationship conflicts, family issues, constant stress, or a dirty look from someone on the street. The stress begins to pick up pace, and other problems appear as a result. It happens so slowly that we don't notice it initially. At that point, any attempt to get out in front of it becomes futile because our cognitive functions have been disabled. It's like searching for a key in a room with the lights off. To find the switch, we have to change identities and fuel sources, even if just for a moment, to reboot our spirit, body, and mind in unison. The old models of treatment. While speaking with experts in the field of medicine, psychiatry, personal development, biohacking, neurofeedback, biofeedback, and neuroscience, I discovered something interesting. They each have their own unique formula for success, but they rarely merge them into one cohesive framework to create lasting change for those of us who are asking more from ourselves. Some of these frameworks include the medical model, diagnoses and treats illness, often prescribing pills to manage symptoms without always uncovering and addressing the root cause, resulting in possible side effects. It views the body as a collection of independent organs that gets divided up by medical specialties. The self-help model drives awareness, uncovers self-sabotaging behavior, inspires through storytelling, and encourages clients to change their beliefs and model the ultra-successful with drops of psychology thrown in for good measure. Unfortunately, it fails to identify any nutritional deficiencies that could be contributing to these behaviors, potentially resulting in short-term success without lasting change. Clients receive an injection of willpower, but when that runs out, they default back to their old preset mode. The therapeutic models, of which there are many, including cognitive, mindfulness, behavioral, and interpersonal therapies. Similar to the self-help model, these therapies may result in patients not making fundamental changes to their biochemistry, giving them only one piece of the puzzle as to why they may lack motivation, drive, focus, and calm. The new models of treatment. Then, we have new models for treating psychological symptoms that are breaking new ground and providing relief for some people who are resistant to other forms of treatment. These also provide a new roadmap for those who want to optimize their psychology outside traditional models. While some are in their infancy, research shows promise. They include the functional medicine model. This model seeks out and addresses the root causes of disease. The field of functional medicine is changing the way illness is treated. Unlike traditional medicine, which views the body as a collection of independent organs, functional medicine views the body as an integrated system. Its objective is to treat the whole body, not just the symptoms, by investigating the patient's lifestyle and biochemical and genetic background to create a science-based approach to their health. The nutritional psychology model. This is the study of how cognitive choices, such as meal decisions, influence nutritional, psychological, and overall health. It seeks to understand the relationship between nutritional behavior and mental health and well-being, and acknowledges and explores the impact that diet has on cognitive function. The psychedelic psychopharmacology model. This model uses psychedelic substances such as psilocybin, magic mushrooms, MDMA, ecstasy, ketamine, or LSD in trauma therapy. Although each drug has a different mechanism, they may induce what researchers call a mystical experience that alters an individual's perceptions of past events, thereby providing relief. Researchers are exploring psilocybin as a treatment for patients with advanced cancer who are suffering serious psychological distress due to their terminal illness. The wearable model. This uses wearable technology to make advances in the field of stress reduction and physical and cognitive optimization. This technology uses physical, tactile, and electrical stimulation and light and sound therapy to alter brain waves and induce an optimal state. The Holy Grail is medical-grade trackers that accurately identify various health issues, such as heart attacks, menstrual cycles, sleep data, and the onset of sickness. At the time of writing, companies ranging from Apple to Fitbit have teamed up with universities to conduct studies to see if their devices can detect COVID-19. This research could lead to preventative measures that would help reduce healthcare costs. Combination of the old and the new. In isolation, these models can generate hit-or-miss results because they fail to cover all bases, but together, they create a potent formula for making you unstoppable. It is not necessarily a question of which model is most effective. It's a question of which combination of models is right for you, based on your personal, physiological, and psychological needs at this time. You will find experts who have preloaded biases, professing their model is the one and only answer. But mental and physical optimization isn't that simple. Receiving an accurate diagnosis will remain the number one challenge for decades to come. Otherwise, you may be using a hammer when in fact you need a nail. And I wanted to add a word of caution. While the use of psychedelics holds promise, there are serious concerns still surrounding it, such as which types of psychological disorders does it treat? How long do the effects last? Does it treat the symptom rather than the cause? For example, if the true cause is a nutritional deficiency, symptoms will reemerge later. Psychedelics may suppress the psychological symptoms for now, but that's just kicking the can down the road. How safe is it? These questions are only beginning to be investigated as the 40-year moratorium that closed down research into psychedelics in the 1970s is coming to an end. Psychiatrists are discovering that strategic, supervised use of these psychopharmacological drugs helps people with post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, alcoholism, depression, and even cluster headaches, although much more research needs to be done. To see if psychedelics should be explored in this new edition of Unstoppable, I reached out to Dr. Dominic J. Sportelli, who is board certified by the American Board of Neurology and Psychiatry in general psychiatry and fellowship trained and board certified in child and.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.